Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another broadcast of Wealth and Wisdom with Fred Belcastro from the John DeVito Broadcast Center on the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network and Jack FM 89.7 WRHS FM Norwich on Friday, May the 5th, the year 2017. And now, here he is, Mr. Fred Belcastro.
When you're smiling,
and the whole world smiles with you.
And when you're laughing,
when
the sun comes shining through. When you're crying, you bring on the rain.
Stop your sighing,
won't you be happy again?
When you're smiling.
Keep on smiling.
Good morning and welcome to the Wealth and Wisdom Show. My name is Fred Belcastro, and I'm going to be your host for the next 30 minutes as we provide financial clarity so that you can create, cultivate, and keep your wealth in a tax-efficient manner. Of course, once again, we're fortunate to be able to broadcast from the John DeVito Broadcast Center here on the northwest side of Chicago. And this Friday morning, you're listening to us on Jack FM 89.7 WRHS, broadcasting out of Norridge, Illinois. This morning, I think we're going to tie things together. Over the previous weeks, we've discussed inflation and the cause and effect of inflation in our individual accounts. And we've also discussed taxation and the bearing that that has on our qualified plans and our everyday living. That's why we talk about creating and cultivating our money in a tax-efficient manner, because we know that anything in a taxable account could be eaten and eroded away by taxes and inflation. So today, discussing the slumpification of what usually confuses us, the financial decisions that we make, if we just categorize and simplify our dollars into three areas, we'll talk about the lifestyle money, and we're going to break our dollars down from the lifestyle money into the accumulated money, and then of course my pet, what makes my practice unique compared to others, perhaps, is the transferred money. Because I said they're more of an opportunity for me to create wealth and sustain wealth and help my clients by helping them avoid the losses rather than sitting at the table in an attempt to hit a home run. My number during the week that I can be reached at is area 630-673-4360. In doing that, talking about our dollars, we know that the dollars are going to either come into our hands and wind up in one of three places. That's the lifestyle, the accumulated, and the money we give away knowingly and unknowingly sometimes. But every dollar you have will filter through one or more of these categories. And that's why the usage and the display that I have with my people would use a personal economic model. I have one in front of me, and in it you can clearly see where the dollars may be going, the lifestyle, what percentage of your money is going out in your lifestyle, what percentage of your money is going out in your to your accumulated dollars, and of course what money, how much money is being transferred away. And when I talk about the transferred, I'm talking about the taxes, interest rates we pay. How about financial fees, up to maybe 4% on some of our qualified accounts, finance charges, the maintenance, management fees, et cetera, from various organizations. I was going to talk, too, about the fees from individual banks. The charges and fees account for more than 40% of the income or the revenues that banks earn. So it's quite sizable, and it's banks are now fee-based operations. You used to think that it was just a matter of interest, but there's they make 40% of their dollars in fees as well. All right, your standard of living. Let's talk about that for a moment. Lifestyle money and the standard of living. This is what we've accumulated, what we use, and where we are at this point, this juncture in our life, is as an accumulation of everything we've learned, everything we've achieved. So what we try and do is maintain and increase this for the rest of our lives. We're always looking to earn more, to overtake inflation, and that's one of our goals. We wake up in the morning and go to work with this lifestyle in mind. So this is not only what we earn, but this is the amount of money that we need to maintain our current standard of living. The neighborhoods we live in. How about the houses we live in? How about the cars we drive? We've discussed the choices and how we derive at those choices over the months that we've been discussing this. How about your vacation? Do you belong to Edgebrook? Do you belong to a country club? All the comforts, all the creature comforts that we become accustomed to, they all fall into the category of our lifestyle money. You know, we work hard. I talk about getting up in the winter at 5 o'clock in the morning and shoveling the snow and digging the car out and pulling it through the alley. We're certainly aware of working to be able to afford to find quality of our lives, but we're more, I think, aware of our lifestyle money than any other types of money, because we live and we get up and we get the checks and our checkbook and we spend the money, and we do this almost every day. A lot of the financial decisions that we make are around our standard of living. But it's unfortunate. I think it's a problem that the cost of our standard of living continues to increase and increase and increase each year. And as we've already learned, because of inflation. If we attempt to live a lifestyle beyond what we can afford, that's where many individuals get into trouble, because they run the risk of becoming buried, I think, in debt. So there's a challenge of maintaining the standard of living and our lifestyle, and especially so after our working years, because it becomes a little bit more complicated once we're retired, because you find yourself on a fixed income at retirement, and if you've made the mistake of following misinformation followed traditional thinking, and we plan to retire on two-thirds of our working income, we said you'll be able to retire because you're in a lower tax bracket, you don't need as much money because you're old and you don't do anything, you feed pigeons in the park, you don't need any money, you need about 65-70%. This was the standard jargon 40-50 years ago. If we find ourselves in that position today, we're going to discover that There's going to be some shocking and dramatic changes to our lifestyle. So everything you buy is going to increase in price along with the taxes. And if we do a 3% inflation, it's a figure we've used. It's a figure that's relatively low with some decades. But nevertheless, if we take a 3% inflation, we can see that once we turn 65, 20 years from now, that dollar has the buying power of 55 cents. Very, very, very important. So the most of the money that we earn will end up in our lifestyle. We'll continue to consume more and more and more of those dollars in the future. The problem again comes in when we try to fund our lifestyle with an increasing amount of debt. So be aware of that. Be aware of the expenses, and we talk about running balance sheets in the personal economic model. We talk about knowing what our lifestyle expenses are, not a budget, but what portion of our dollars are necessary to maintain our lifestyle, along with the increasing taxation and inflation. Very, very, very important. We talked about, I might make make mention of that if we have time at the conclusion of our transferred dollars discussion. But I'd like to talk about accumulation. Everybody wants to talk about how much money they have. I've got a money accumulator. This is the earnings I put away. This is the amount of dollars I've saved with good intentions and the best attempts through the last 40 years that I've been working. We've managed to put some money away in a savings program, a retirement program, an investment. We've got some money in the bank, and so we feel pretty comfortable, pretty good about what we may have accomplished. Average American, though, they say, is finding more and more difficult to save and accumulate money. Well, we've talked about the reasons for it. We're saving at the lowest rate. I've seen figures that since the ending of the Great Depression, this was in the middle 30s, we're saving less now. A lot of things we're not having to discuss why we're not saving any money. I found that as a youngster in the business, people planning that, gee, once we get our income taxes paid this year, we'll have money. Once we have our roof fixed on our home, we're going to have money. Once we pay off the car, we'll have money. Once the kids are through school, we'll have money. And it goes on and on and on. And we find ourselves never quite able to do what we'd like to do unless we make some drastic changes, our inability to fund our future lifestyles. But this is everyone, you know. I did had a lot of clients in the Norwich area, and it impacts everyone. So we got the banks, we got the fees in the banks, we got financial planners, we got investment bankers and brokers. They're all chasing the dollar. They're all chasing for the money that we're trying to save. In the financial world, there's a tremendous amount of information, misinformation. Yeah, you would think that all the education that we get from everyone, the magazines, remember Money Magazine coming out and Forbes Magazine, all this great information, all these news articles, Barron's giving us articles in the Wall Street Journal and O'Neill's Business Daily, giving us information. How about TV? People are glued to the TV, watching the stock reports, radio shows, of all the experts that are on radio show, record number of experts out there. Be almost impossible. How can you possibly lose money with all the great information? Turn out to be the opposite. You know, I told a 100-man story about 96% of us are going to wind up at age 65 either dead or dead broke. Those same statistics from the Social Security Administration are applicable today. Well, I did that in workshops and seminars 50 years ago. All this information, and we haven't taken a step in the right direction because it's misinformation. The sleight of hand makes good sound bites. Sounds good. Hey, it sounds like I know what I'm talking about. But for the average guy trying to save money, difficult, tough, and what makes it even tougher, misinformation, and it's difficult, I think, to separate the opinions of individual companies or individual representatives from fact, the myth from the reality, the truth from fiction. What is it from 1967? What we have here is a failure to communicate, taken from an old movie. We don't have a failure to communicate. We communicate all right, but we give sleight of hand information. Who has a personal economic model? Who has taken the time to distribute this money, to know what's in what we may call a yellow tank? What's at risk? How much money do we have in safety? What's the proportion of the two? Is our homes a place to save and accumulate money? How much are we earning on our homes? Hey, my home's a good investment. Well, how much is it made for you? Have we listed it? See, all we have, all we think about sometimes, I don't like to say, but listen, we used to say in the brokerage business that you sell the greed, right? Not the need. You sell the greed because greed and ambition seems to motivate the people to forego the truth. When it's profitable for them, you're going to discover that your accumulated money may be the smallest group of monies that you have, the type of money that you have. But yet our entire future from 60, 65, or 70, whenever it is that we stop earning a paycheck, our whole future and our survival depend on it. I've been called into on settlements with people losing their homes, people in advanced age losing their homes. The inability, I think, to save money and increase their lifestyle will depend on understanding and controlling, not the accumulated money, the third type of money, the transferred money. But why don't we just take a moment and hear what four guys have to say about life.
January to December, we'll have moments to
the New Year's Eve, we did the town. The day we tore the goalpost down. We will have these moments to remember. The quiet walks, the noisy fun, the ballroom prize we almost won. We will have these moments to remember. Though summer turns to winter and the present disappears, and other days may find us gone our separate ways. We will have these moments to remember.
The drive-in movie, where we'd go, and somehow never watch the show.
We will have these moments to remember. Though summer turns to winter and the present disappears, the laughter we were glad to share will echo through the years. When other nights and other days may find us gone our separate ways, we will have these moments to
That was another of the big hits from the Four Lads from 1955. All right, we're back with the Wealth and Wisdom program. I want to thank you for listening to us every Friday morning. I certainly enjoy doing this program and working with John DeVita, the director here, to provide some information, and I think another viewpoint, because we're living in a time... Boy, all of us need to become really financially savvy, and we can only become financially savvy by gaining, by learning, by getting information, and learning how money really works. If you'd like to discuss it personally with me, my phone number is area 630-673-4360. I'd like to end the program by going through transferred money. It's one of our... It's what I do. It's what I believe makes me unique. as compared to other guys. Other guys will sit down and talk to you and say, hi, how are you? Boy, do I have something great for you. Where do you have your money at? Oh, that? Okay, what are you earning on it? Well, you're earning X percent. We could do better than that. You need what we have. And I go into my trick box and pull out a product or a club and say, hey, you'll golf par with this product. This is what everybody's using today. It's over the last 50 years, and that's why people find themselves no better off now than they did 50 years ago. I want to talk about the third type. This is what I look at, and it'll surprise you, I think, once you sit down and you see how much of the money you're really throwing away, knowingly or unknowingly. Transfers in the wealth, I find, appear how you pay your taxes. And I'm not just talking about your 1040. There's more to it than just get back money every year. There's more to it. So when I talk about how you pay your taxes, it applies to everything that you do. We discuss the amount of taxes that you paid last year. I could read off maybe 50 or 100 of them on some of the sheets I have. Nevertheless, it's taxes, interest rates, how you finance things, your finance fees, the finance charges you're paying people, the maintenance and management fees. It goes on and on and on. Remember that the beneficiaries of these transfers, right? Get this in your mind. Listen to me here. Not because you've got to do everything I say, but just understand these transfers, federal, state, local governments, render to Caesar what's Caesar. I'm not saying don't pay your taxes, but the banks, loan companies, mortgage companies, investment companies, everyone's focusing on the lifestyle. And everyone, all the representative advisors, focusing on the accumulated money. Let me tell you something. The answer to increasing your money, the answer to increasing your wealth, is hidden in the transfers, the money that you knowingly or unknowingly transfer away. See, but the basis of my discussions and my programs is learning to recognize and understand and then take back some of these transfers in their life, allowing you to create more money and allowing you to create in a tax-efficient manner. This is why I say with clarity, see and understand. Do you have a budget? Do you have an economic model? If you don't have an economic model, how can you see what you're doing? How could you understand the flow of your dollars? The more transfers in your wealth that are involved in, the more your lifestyle, and I think your accumulated money as well, is going to be decreased. You got to learn to categorize the money, and that's the purpose of this program this morning, the three areas of your money. Because your dollars are going to end up supporting you, either the lifestyle, you're going to save them or invest them for your future, or they're going to be given away. Any attempt to increase your income or improve your standard of living and save money are triggered by events in your life. As you increase your lifestyle, as we increase our savings, as we earn more and more dollars, you know, in our employment and our skills, you'll incur an increase in taxes. Now and the possibility of the future taxes as well. So even increasing the amount you save can create greater problems of taxation in the future. It seems that every time you try to save a dollar, every time you take a step forward, you're going to have to give a dollar away or take a step back a little bit. So we want to expand our standard of living. You want to have new homes and repairs and televisions and big plasma televisions and the LEDs and better automobiles and safer and home improvements and new dishwashers. And how about those new countertops and the furniture and cabinets and things of this nature? But the problem is sometimes this stuff is bought on credit, and this debt has a fee attached to it. You have an interest rate that you've got to pay. You know, almost every purchase in your life, the things that we buy are all depreciating assets. And we replace them, even the carpeting, even the furniture. We know we do other things with the TV. None of us are watching a 7-inch black and white helicopter TV. So when you buy a new car, realize at the time you drive it out of the dealership, a 20-30% decrease in value, and it keeps decreasing in value no matter how many times you bring it to the corner and have it washed. Even purchasing a home is expensive. It's surrounded by transfers in the form of interest rates, property taxes, school tax, water, sewer, maintenance, improvement, gutters, and how about the insurance costs that we have to pay. So a lot of banks, mortgages, credit companies, they look at your buying habits. This is their job. A dollar from you is a dollar for them. Unfortunately, with maybe possible exceptions on the mortgage interest you pay, all your other debt is not tax deductible. As you can see, the transfers consume an awful lot of your money. If you had an opportunity, let's say you had a chance to look back and all the money that you've given away in interest fees and financial costs and take back those money, what would that amount to? Well, in my practice, I've seen hundreds of thousands of dollars. Unfortunately, many people, we can't go back. Unfortunately, a lot of people don't know how to do this. There's a reason why no one's teaching you how to get this money. If the banks, let me tell you this. If the banks, credit card companies, and all these companies, the mortgage companies, investment companies, and if the government, everybody told us how to reduce our payments to them, they'd get less money. Is that what they're in the business for? Do they want less money? Mortgage companies want less money. They give us all, listen, I'm going to help you. You're saving interest here. They know what they're doing. You might be saving interest on one end, but you're giving away interest on the other. Look at both sides. Take your, again, take your model. Take a look. Take a look at the sheets. You know, these companies know. They understand the first defining moment that we talked about over the weeks. They know that the money is never going to be worth more than it is right now, today. What they've got to do is simply get as much of your money today where it'll have the most buying power for them. I think about the people working for 40, 45, 50 years in a position to work hard to pay for all these expenses and all these transfers and all these giveaway in their life. It's a wonder that they have time to learn how to reduce or really eliminate them. Let's see what we should be doing, though. Let's listen to these guys and see what they tell us. What should we be doing, John?
Standing on the corner, watching all the girls go by. Standing on the corner, watching all the girls go by. You don't know a nicer occupation. Matter of fact, neither do I. Than standing on the corner, watching all the girls, watching all the girls, watching all the girls go by.
I'm the cat that got the creep. Haven't got a girl, but I can. Down to Main Street, and that's where I select my imaginary dish.
Standing on the corner, watching all the girls go by. Standing on the corner, giving all the girls the eye. Brother, if you've got a rich imagination, give it a whirl. Give it a try. Try standing on the corner, watching all the girls, watching all the girls, watching all the girls go by.
Saturday, and I'm so broke. Haven't got a girl, and that's no joke. Still, I'm living like a millionaire when I take me down to Maine.
Main Street, and I review the harem parading for me there.
Standing on the corner, watching all the girls go by. Standing on the corner, underneath the springtime sky. Brother, you can't go to jail for what you're thinking, or for the woo look in your eye. You're only standing on the corner, watching all the girls, watching all the girls, watching all the girls go by.
In memory, here I am standing in the corner, watching all the girls go by with the four lads from 1956, and the time got away from me a little bit. Well, next week I'd like to continue the discussion. I think I beat the horse to death here with the three types of money. Understand that simplification will help you understand where your money is going and what you can do and what you should be doing with the dollars. We'll talk about next week. I think I'd like to talk about the rate of return you're getting on your money, the need to save dollars. Do you need to save? Maybe you don't need to save. How long do you have to work in order to maintain that standard of living beyond your working years? Or if we have to reduce our standard of living, how much do we have to reduce it by? Do we have to take in the rumors? I ran across that line this week. What we've got here is a failure to communicate. We communicate all wrong. All right, thanks for listening. Enjoyed talking with you. A special shout out to our executive producer, John Chikanda, and of course my partner here, John DeVita, managing and directing these shows, keeping me between the lines and making all this possible. We thank you. Thank you for listening. I certainly enjoy talking to you. Look forward to talking to you again next week. And in the sunshine, let's go out today and make somebody smile.
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
and the whole world smiles with you.
Smiles with you.
And when you're laughing,
when you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing,
oh, you're laughing.
When the sun comes shining through,
shining through.
When you're crying,
when you're crying,
you bring on the rain,
bring on the
stop
rain.
Your sighing,
stop your sighing.
Won't you be happy again?
Happy again.
When you're smiling,
when you're smiling,
keep on smiling,
keep on smiling.
And the world will smile.
You have been listening to Wealth and Wisdom with Fred Belcastro from the John DeVita Broadcast Center on Jack FM 89.7 WRHS FM Norwich and the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network on Friday, May the 5th, the year 2017. This broadcast was directed by John DeVita. Our special thanks to radio station manager Kevin Zeflik of WRHS-FM Norwich, and the executive producer of Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network, Mr. John Chikanda. Until next time, please be safe and thanks for listening. Today's broadcast was pre-recorded on Wednesday, May the 3rd, the year 2017. And this is Jack FM 89.7 WRHS FM, Norwich, Illinois. Have a safe and enjoyable weekend.